water, because if we had the hot water, we could be able to scrub and clean ourselves and clean our body. There's so many things we could purify. If we had the cold water, we could do something with the cold water, because we could clean our clothes with the cold water and use it to drink. We could do something with that. But this lukewarm water, we can't use it at all. Lord have mercy. And just like you don't like that lukewarm water and you spit it out, I spit you out the same. Lord have mercy. That you need a hot or cold. Your room temperature. So I spit you out. Lord have mercy. And the vision of God looking at us and saying, I love you, but I don't want this kind of relationship with you. I will always be by your side. I will never leave you or forsake you. But I really don't want the kind of relationship you have with me. I will be with you till the end of the earth, but the relationship we're having is not what I'm really looking for. I'm committed to the relationship. I got on the cross and I died for your sins, and I put nails in my hand and nails in my feet. This thing is not what I'm looking for. This thing is not what I want to have. This thing is not exactly what I died on the cross. Lord have mercy. He's like, look. If somebody dies for you and says they would die over and over for you, they want to see the same passion that they have.
Yeah, yeah.
That you would have that for them.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm. No, am I crazy? But I'm trying to get you to see the text and see what she was trying to say. Because it was, she used in the movie clip, she used the simple thing of coughing to describe the point to her. But the point was powerful, because that's not what God wants. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. That means God is involved in a relationship with a billion Christians all over the world. And probably 90% of them are not satisfied. Y'all know how y'all feel when you're not satisfied in one relationship. Y'all better help me now. You know how you feel when you're not satisfied in one relationship. How does God feel to be not satisfied in maybe 900 million people who call themselves Christian but live in this lukewarm relationship with Him, unwillingness to commit themselves to Him, always backing out of relationship, always backing out of commitments, always backing out of the things that God has called you to do, that God created you for, that you don't do, the kind of God you don't share with God, that you share with everybody else. Time you spend on the phone talking to your best friend, but you don't spend on your knees talking to the one who holds your best friend and holds your life in order. The one who said, oh, come on, somebody help me today. We're talking about this relationship with God and coming to grips with what God really wants to do in your life. And so when we look at the text, we recognize that God said some powerful things in the text to challenge us to a greater relationship with Him. He said some powerful things in the text to move us forward in relationship with Him. Lord have mercy. And so he says, first of all, I want you to understand that I know your work.
Yeah.
And so God says in verse 15, I know your works. And I know that you're neither cold nor hot. Meaning, I know you're lukewarm. He says, wait a minute, to judge the relationship is not what you say. by what you do.
Yes, sir.
He said, wait a minute, when I judge how much you love me and have passion for me, you can say you love me all over, up and down, right and left. God said, you can say all that, but I ain't looking at what you say. I'm looking at what you do. I know your works, and your words may say you love me. Your words may say that you're hot. Your words may say that you're up. You want me. Your words may say that you're passionate. Your words may say all these things, but I'm seeing what you're doing. And I judge you on whether you are passionate or lukewarm based on what you do. So what are we doing? If you don't spend any time with the Lord, he said, wait a minute. Check yourself. You think you're passionate. You think you love him. You think you care so much for him. But how much time are you really spending? You think you're passionate. You think you care. I love the Lord. I give so much time to church. But how much time do you really spend sitting at the master's feet? But you don't understand me. You don't understand me, preacher. I give it myself. I give my life. I give my money. I give my time. I give my energy. But how much time, not to the institution of the church, but how much time do you give yourself to get it before God and lay it prostrate before him and call out his name and looking to him for every direction of your life? How much time do you spend laying out before God, crying and weeping before God, I love you, I ain't never leave you, I'll always be by your side, I'll always be here for you, because I'm God, I'm never going to turn away from you, and you're saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. I always will be with you, don't worry about it, but I want you to know, I ain't satisfied with that. This is not the question of whether I'm walking out. I'm not like your love relationship. God said, I'm not walking out on you. But I still got to let you know what I'm not satisfied with. Y'all better hear me. I'm still right with you every day of your life, and I still will always be with you, and I'll always care for you. I will always love you. I want you to see that, which I want you to understand that this thing we're doing right now is not satisfying to God. And in the long run, it's not satisfying to you either. Because so much of the blessing you really want to have in your life, you're spending time passionately running other places to look for and not looking to me. And so you're running here and there trying to find the joy, going out to the club trying to find the joy, going over to the senior club to find the joy, going out to go on trips and bus trips, places, clubs and fellowships and friendships with people to find the joy. He says, wait, I know your works. I know what you're doing. And you look warm. You look warm. You look warm. And we can do better than this. We can do better than this. We can do better. You look warm. Do you spend time with me? Do you pray? Do you worship? Do you sing to me? Do you go before me? Do you sing spiritual songs? Do you love me with your whole heart? Do you love me with your whole mind? Do you love me with your whole soul? Do you think about me? Do you have holy worship with me? Do you spend time? Do you serve me? And do you serve me with joy? Are you serving me with joy each and every day in your life? Or what you're doing, is it going to bless somebody? Is it going to help somebody? Do you really love your neighbor? Can you forgive somebody? Can you forgive your neighbor? Do you ever forgive your neighbor? Do you forgive your friends? Do you give grace and mercy to other people in your life? Do you remember me when you're dealing with your friendships and with your family and give me the glory in the midst of those relationships? Do you deal with when you look at your finances? Do you give me the glory and through your finances? Do you, when you go through all the struggles you go through in life, are you still finding the time to give me praise and to give me glory even for the tribulation? Because the tribulation work of patience, patience experience hope, and hope make them not ashamed, but the love of God shed abroad in our And if you give him praise and give him praise in the midst of acting, he still would use them for the good in your life. You can still give me praise in the midst of that, because that's how I know when you love me. When you praise me when things ain't right, when you praise me when things are wrong, when you praise me when things are crazy, when you praise me when things are difficult, when you praise me when you're tribulation, when you praise me when you're in a tough position, when you praise me, when you praise me, when you praise me with all the trouble that you're going through. That's how I know how much you love me, when you praise me when the stuff is bad.
But I don't want to go in the house.
Because I know what I'm going to get when I get
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, so I'm out here playing, but everybody else went in the house. So I'm out here all by myself, scared to go in the house. Lord, but scared to be out here. Scared to go in the house because I know what's going to happen. But scared because I'm out here and these people crazy out here. What do I do? And some of us stay right in this position, and this is the lukewarm position of trying to decide whether I'm going to go into the house, I'm going to be in relationship with God, I'm going to give my passion to God, I'm going to give my love to God, because you're concerned that God won't spank you. And you don't want to get spanked. You know some stuff you've been doing while you've been out and playing around, Lord have mercy, and not pleasing to God. You've been messing up and doing some things that's not right with God, and you know it's not right with God. And so now you don't know whether you want to go in to be with God. You don't know if you want to go in and spend time with God. You don't know if you want to be able to relate with God. You don't know if you want to really be in deep relationship with God. You don't know if you have passion for God. You don't know if you want to really love God because you're scared to love Him, because you don't know what He's going to do because you're scared about what you've been doing. Because God will rebuke and chasten who He loves. So we stay out here being lukewarm. We stay out here never really embracing God. We stay out here running and say, don't you know, I could have been out there all night running around. But I finally had to say, even with a woman, it's better to be in my house than to be out here.
Yes, 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 yes.
Y'all better hear me now.
Yes.
That's right. Get in the house. So I ran to my mom and I tried to, I know I kind of lost track of time. I'm sorry. Come on in. The thing is on the table. Come on in. I love you. Yeah, she loved me already. Because as soon as I got in the house, I'm dancing around. And that's the repent. Oh Lord, my mama, I won't do it again. Yeah. That's the repent. I won't do it again. Yeah, you get your spanking. Unless you get spanked, you're not going to say you're not going to do it again. Hear what God's saying. He said, unless He chastise you, you're going to do the same thing over and over again, and you're never going to be blessed. But God wants to bless you because God says, I got some things for you, but I can't let you do those things and harm yourself. I have to spank you. I have to chastise you. I have to get you to a point of repentance where you say, God, I'm sorry, God, I'll never do it again.
Sir, full pastor teaching.
And then God, just like my mom, has a provision laid out on the table for you. All the food, all the things you need. And she loves you and holds you and protects you. God loves you, holds you, protects you, covers you after He spanked you. And then you're reminded about how much you love God. Because after my mom did all that stuff, I'd come over and give her a big hug and want to just lay up in her arms. Lord have mercy. And the chastisement made me closer to her.
Yes, sir.
Something like that.
Yes, sir.
The discipline made me closer
to her.
The punishment that I needed made me closer to her. And that's what God will do the same. But you don't need to be out here all lukewarm for God because you're scared of God. God says, take this chastisement. And as you take that chastisement, you will feel closer to God because God will love you more. I don't know if you understand. But after I got my spanking, the cookies taste better. After I got my spanking, the food on the table tastes better. After I got my spanking, I got more extra ice cream on the plate. Because after I got my spanking, I got some extra stuff there. I got some extra candy later. I got some candy tucked in the bag. meeting.